this on? Good evening, and thanks to all of you for joining us this evening for the launch of Lisa Ray's first book. Having read the book, I am certain that there'll be several more, and perhaps we'll all be gathering here every couple of years if AD would have us. When we received the book in office a couple of months ago, an early copy, a colleague of mine started reading it and came up to me and said, has she really written this? It's really good. I was instantly irritated, you know, the stereotypes we have about women, about beautiful women, about what women can achieve. And I stayed irritated with this colleague for a while. Also because I know, I mean, having met Lisa a couple of times over the last few years, I know how dedicatedly she was working on this book. I know she was at it since 2010. When I visited her flat in Bandra, she had this big fat manuscript on a desk in her bedroom, and it's all she wanted to talk about. So I knew she was perfectly capable of writing a good book. But then I read the book, and unfortunately, I had the same doubt as my colleague. Has she really written this? Because it's more than a good book. It's the kind of book that stirs you. It's the kind of memoir that does the heavy lifting for the reader to excavate their own synchronous emotions that Lisa writes about in the book, from love, ambition, hope, loss, insecurity, family, failure, all of it. Which is not to say it's all about emotion. There's a lot of masala in there for those who are looking for it. Right at the beginning, we have a young Lisa thwacking the son of an industrialist across his forehead with a shoe because he tried to grope her in his shoe closet. We have Lisa's formidable mother in a wheelchair accosting burglars who've entered their home saying, "You want to kill me? What's the worst you can do? Kill me right now." The burglar is sent running away. We have the underworld, we have a Mr. X, we have flirting with Sean Penn, which was not what I knew about earlier, at a Vanity Fair party. So, and there's this fabulous part that I call Lisa's Jab We Met moment with a happy ending. And I think before we even start the questions, I'd love for you to read that part, just to set the tone of you as a 16-year-old backpacker in Croatia, landing up at this doorstep.
Yes, thank you so much. And I also quickly wanted to say that having Anandita here today conducting this is a great honor. We're both of Bengali origin. And, you know, only if you are Bengali will you understand what I mean when we say that, you know, in the blood, in our genes, is contained this kind of a literary collage. You know, and even if you don't manifest it in your life, but I think somewhere we all aspire to have something to do with words. You know, it's something that's passed on to us, and it's considered perhaps the highest calling. And so, you know, I'm really greatly honored to have her here today and to be a champion of the book for a lot of the reasons also that she's mentioned, because I quickly wanted to say, of course, you know, there are certain perceptions of someone who has inhabited the business that I have inhabited for many years when I started at 16. And, you know, your image sort of calcifies at a certain point of time when you've been doing this as long as you have. Where the truth of the matter is, I've always been a misfit. I've always had this very strange, unique ability to sort of be, you know, inhabit a situation, and then a certain part of me is watching, to be an observer. And then I've always also had a notepad in my back pocket. And today, of course, it's maybe notes in my iPhone, but I've always taken notes. I've always been an observer of both my life and the life around me. So I've just been looking for an opening to be able to share my insights, my misadventures, and the many sort of triumphs and dark periods that I've been through. So Anandita, I'm gonna start with, where do you suggest I start? That this was 1991 and Yugoslavia, where had we said?
finally reached my destination in Croatia.
Yes.
Can I give you the part I've marked, if that's okay?
Okay. And I'm just going to do that.
As much as you'd like to, and we can stop off.
I've got it right here. So yeah, so I was always rather rebellious, trying to challenge the conventions and the norms. So I decided that I was going to take off. My parents packed me off to Switzerland with sort of a guardian. And I decided that Switzerland felt a lot like Canada, which was boring and very sterile. So I decided spontaneously to buy a ticket to Croatia, to Yugoslavia. What was Yugoslavia at the time? To chase down this very cute boy that I knew back in Toronto.
We'd given you an open invitation, a vague kind of invitation.
A very vague invitation, you know, thinking that nobody's actually going to follow up on this vague invitation. I finally reached my destination in Croatia, a village close to Split, the largest coastal town in the country. It was early morning, the sun just breaking. When you fancy yourself a traveler and not a tourist, you develop a taste for disorienting arrivals. It's always early morning or late at night when you stumble into a new place and you are alone except for some solitary cab driver or another misfit like yourself. This very large feeling hits me on every arrival of this nature. I am an insignificant dot, a minuscule part of creation. I remember having one of those moments looking around that empty Croatian village. It was unkempt, like a wild girl gone to seed, bristly grass poking out from the gravel everywhere. Outside the whistle stop was the one taxi and a dusty road. The driver was dozing. I woke him and showed him my map. When I presented myself at Goran's door at 6 a.m., suitcase at my feet, the palest scale was behind me, turning me into a silhouette. Now that I was here, I had no idea what reception I would get. Goran was quite naturally surprised and sleepy, patting his hands over his hair self-consciously. But I was immediately welcome to stay. Yawning young faces emerged from inner rooms to gawk at me over Goran's shoulder. The house was full. There were cousins and kids with indecipherable ties. She's my mother's aunt's second cousin's daughter, spilling out of everywhere, but not a single adult. I was quickly absorbed into that youthful chaos, and under the gaze of so many eyes, Goran and I embarked on a whirlwind romance. After all, there's no spare room, so you're just going to have to sleep with me. He was an incredibly sexy guy, brooding with thick, dark, floppy hair. Almost every man I've been with since has possessed a variation on this look.
This is the cue for everyone to look at Jason right now, sitting in the front row.
But at the same time, I had just recently discovered boys in earnest. Goran's family's home was a Spartan but comfortable three-story house constructed of a simple whitewashed cement set on the side of a hill. Soon, word spread and most of the neighbors came by curious about this Canadian girl who had just shown up. Goran and I were trailed when we linked fingers and walked to the village center for coffee and to call my parents. The town seemed relatively prosperous. The small iron tables in the cafes were full, though no one seemed preoccupied with work. It was functioning on a typical Eastern European remittance economy where family members who had gone abroad sent money back to relatives who stayed behind. You could see the homes built from that money, slightly newer, slightly fresher, with television antennas, but still cinder block and whitewashed with a red roof. We would swim in the local swimming hole, a scenic bend in the river, where a large tree provided an overhanging branch from which the more adventurous boys would launch themselves into the water. It was a fine way for them to preen and show off. We'd walk for miles through cornfields, sometimes for no reasons, sometimes to visit an impressive hog. Goran's female cousin showed me how they made dolls out of corn stalks. At night, Goran and I slept on a mattress in the loft, whispering in the light of a battery-powered lantern. I remember lying very still next to Goran, holding in my happiness while the moon spilled drapes of light from a window set high under the roof.
Thanks. So hopefully that gives you a little taste of the book in terms of, you know, the storytelling and the anecdotal writing, which is, I think, restricted to the first half. And then we move on to more of an internal exploration. So Lisa, I want to start with talking about structure and style. Because you've said in recent interviews that the way the story was told was as important to you as the story itself. And you really fought for that. You withdrew a really lucrative publishing deal, fought with your agent. A lot of things went down there. So what was your starting point in terms of storytelling? Who are the memoirists that you've really admired? You know, where did you get the seed of how you were going to tell the story?
That's a great question. So a lot of the memoirists that I have admired or that I've read recently, the one that pops to mind recently is something called Educated by Tara Westover. And I really endorse this book and recommend it to absolutely everyone. But my taste is that, exactly as Anindita said, it's not just a story, it's also how the story is told. The quality of writing, you know, there should be a little bit of enigma in the story, that the places where your own imagination can perhaps fill in the gaps, where you can meet the experience of the author. So not every single thing should be spelled out. And I really obviously respond to writing. What I find I connect with the most is in a great specificity and getting very specific in describing taste, smell, you know, the way that the light falls on someone's glasses. I actually find myself there, transported, but in that, I also find, I identify my own personal experiences. And that's really, really important for me, is to, in the very specific, we find the universal. And you find yourself, and you find your own experiences. And so I wanted to also emphasize that, again, I imagine that there will be perceptions, obviously, about my memoir, and amongst them, which would be very legitimate, is that it's a cancer memoir, that it all has to do with my battling this disease, which I've been very public about. And in a sense, it's not. I do cover my cancer experiences, but that comes much later. Although, having said that, cancer was the launching pad for writing this memoir, because initially that's why I was approached to write this. And it was, I was approached off of a blog that I had written called The Yellow Diaries, in which I chronicled my cancer experiences literally week by week by week. And I was using writing, which is something I've always turned to my entire life, to try to process and decode a very emotional, very challenging period that I was going through. So off of that, I was offered you know, the opportunity to write my memoir. When I sat down and thought about it, I realized that I couldn't write about my disease in isolation from the rest of my life, because everything is connected with what came before, you know? And, you know, it's also connected with a part of my Buddhist philosophy, which is something that has also deeply influenced my personal worldview and my healing. So if my disease does not happen in isolation from the rest of my life, how far back do I have to go? And I realized that I had to start from the beginning, and the beginning was actually my parents' story. So even though I actually start the memoir with describing myself, preparing myself to actually share my diagnosis of cancer publicly on the red carpet at the Toronto International Film Festival, after that I segue into my childhood, but more importantly, into my parents. And this was a revelation for me in writing the book. If I had to pick a single revelation, something that I didn't anticipate, it was my parents, you know? So as I said, I kind of fancy myself a bohemian, a rebel, someone who challenges the norm. Where did that come from? And I realized that it was passed on in what I describe my kaleidoscopic genes. You know, my father's a Bengali, my mother's Polish, And between the two of them, they created this strange creature.
You go beyond your parents to your grandparents
and
as well.
And also to my grandparents. Yes. So thank you for reminding me.
A
yes.
A lot of the book, I mean, you've spent a lot of time in setup, right? Starting from your Bengali grandfather who was a judge, him sitting in his planter's chair in this palatial Calcutta home reading Jugantor, which is a specific type of intellectual, read that. And to your Polish grandmother who divided the world into elegant and not elegant.
Non-elegant, yes.
So, which is what I wanted to kind of ask you next about how important context was to you, but you've kind of already answered that. In a way, you know, your rebellious spirit and your kind of love for travel and adventure was something that your parents sowed in you. I mean, they picked up and just moved to Bombay and lived in ISKCON, which is a wild story in itself, when you were 16. And your mother was sneaking in chicken soup into the all-vegetarian ISKCON living quarters. So I think a little bit of your naughty streak is possibly from them.
And it's interesting because we normally don't frame our parents and our lineage in those terms, particularly when we're younger. You know, we see our parents through a very different framework. You know, they are more, perhaps sometimes, they're the rule makers. You know, they provide a safe container for us, but they also provide borders and rules that you're not supposed to traverse. And, you know, when I actually started speaking to my father, I said, tell me a little bit more, because he was always a little bit shy about sharing the entire breadth of my parents' romance, because it was not easy in those days for a Pole and a Bengali Brahmin to get together. Like, that was quite a spicy romance, but they would always get kind of giggle behind their hands whenever they confronted them and questioned them about it. So I kind of pinned him down and got him to tell me about that, but more importantly, about how my father was essentially excommunicated from his family. It was a very liberal family, a very educated family, but still excommunicated from his family for not marrying the woman of his family's choice. And how my parents had to then make a go of it independently. And the choices that they made, I think in any context, but even more so for the period in which they were living, you know, the 50s and the 60s, was extremely rebellious, extremely brave, extremely visionary, and very ahead of their times. But I did not see it that way. And today I can see that this rebellious streak, basically, I had no choice in the matter but to become a rebel and to basically challenge a lot of things. It was basically embedded in my marrow. From my blood, it was embedded in my marrow. And as I said, the choices that both my parents made and that I ended up making provided a lot of blessings and a lot of trauma both, you know. But, you know, that is the responsibility inherent in our lives, is we do have to take responsibility for our choices. And I do also want to say, Anandita, you had actually brought this up, that there's a lot of joy also, even though I write very frankly about a lot of the obstacles and trauma and difficulties. I've also studied a certain amount of, immersed myself in asking questions, not necessarily always finding the answers, but asking the questions, immersing myself in Buddhism, immersing myself in a lot of Osho's teachings, in a lot of, you know, going on a spiritual road trip, which is kind of wild, in a golden car, and not necessarily finding the answers, but in being able to accept the entire package of life, both the light and the shadow, and understanding and not judging it as good or bad, but this is the great glory of life.
Well, there's definitely a lot of humor in the writing. I mean, you speak about how the journey of your cancer treatment started off with learning how to floss your teeth. I mean, you know, one would expect something far more grave and serious from a person who's been on a spiritual road trip. I thought maybe you'll go on this final pilgrimage before starting the treatment, but you learned how to floss because that's apparently important.
Yes, because I had very bad dental hygiene before that.
So there is a lot of humor interspersed, and I wonder how all your spiritual lessons from, you know, from Buddhism to Osho to your trips to Shirdi, kind of added to that. But before we get to the spiritual part, which is a whole big chunky part, I would say that's the heart of the book in itself, I want to talk about the idea of leaving that seems to be a running trope through the book. Lisa Ray leaving, leaving Toronto for Mumbai, leaving Mumbai for London, leaving Maureen Vadia's luxurious abode to strike it out on your own, leaving London to come back, you know, setting up in Milan, Paris, renting a flat in New York. So you seem to be leaving even lucrative projects, men's, all of that. So when did you kind of come to terms with this idea of leaving? When did it stop being a failure and become a strength? The idea that you could just pick up and go.
That's a great question. I should preface it with saying, baby, I'm not going to leave you. And just in case we take this theme to its natural conclusion, I think that's, I mean, I start out at one point by saying I believe I was born a nomad. And that also, I think, is a little bit due to also my parents and what they passed on to me. And leaving, this idea of departures and at the same time arrivals, has been a very strong theme in my life that I think I'm still trying to understand. I think when I was younger, leaving and moving was more about moving away from, leaving something behind, trying to change my circumstances by leaving my environment. Or, you know, just kind of obeying this very restless kind of call in my blood, this mania. It was like traveling in a little bit more of a mania. And also trying to, you know, it was adrenalized. It was like the next experience, the next city, the next this, the next that. Don't hold me down because maybe I was too afraid of confronting
you write
and staying
in
with
one
myself.
Part about how your mind felt choked with mud when you were stagnant back in Toronto. So you have tried to really poeticize and understand and philosophize that part as well. And it didn't always work in your favor. You've written about how your friend Sujata Asumol kind of was worried. You were being labeled this errant runaway model, like, yeah, should you be given campaigns? Because no one knows when you're going to pick up and go. So it hasn't always worked in your favor.
No, it hasn't at all. But to the second part of your question, Anandita, I do feel that today there is a certain part of me that has, I have a kind of a solid faith in let's say impermanence. And impermanence is a concept that can sound very frightening and very destabilizing. But if you actually embrace impermanence, which at its core, like it or not, is the true reality of this world that we inhabit, once you kind of become more comfortable with that, in whatever way it takes you to become comfortable with that, and life has certainly thrown a lot of experiences in my way. Okay, if you didn't learn that lesson, here's another lesson to help you become comfortable with the impermanence and the constant changes in life. As I became more at ease with that, that mania in me of always having to leave has kind of smoothed out. So I still travel a lot. For instance, just 4 weeks ago, my husband and I have decided that now we've left Hong Kong and we're now based in Bombay, and just like
that. Leaving again.
So leaving, yes, but going to something with a kind of an intention and with a very, I try to be really, really honest with myself today. It's taken a lot of practice to get there. I'm not always successful at it. So I try to call myself on stuff. What am I actually trying to escape? I'm not escaping something. I know that I am coming to something. So the mania has left. I'm a lot more comfortable with impermanence. So I try not to get too attached to any particular situation. I watch myself. Obviously, it's very difficult practice with family, with friends. But this idea of moving and being able to be fluid, I think, is an asset. It's a very strong asset, particularly in today's world where there's a lot of migration, where the world, as we know it, is changing constantly around us. And I know that a lot of people are spinning out of control because of that.
You had this Ayurvedic doctor explain that to you, saying your dosha was vata. So I guess you
vata.
Kind of understood it that way. There's a beautiful, at some point in the book, when you understand what's going on with all this leaving, you write about how you realized you were not adrift like a leaf in a storm, but riding hidden currents of air. So you made that some kind of strength.
It's, I think, more about surrender, which again is a very scary word and implies that you're passive, but surrender means being aligned with these kind of hidden currents that are running beneath us all constantly, and that sometimes maybe we don't have to struggle so hard, we don't have to effort some so hard, that we can still be ambitious, that we can still have a particular vision for our life and intention, but we can let go a little bit. And we can be carried along with those currents, and we will get to where we need to go. And that's a really interesting teaching, and I think that's just an interesting philosophy to at least contemplate, if not embrace in your life.
Lisa, you write about, and it comes up a couple of times in the book, how the birth of your success in your mind is forever linked to the accident that you faced as a family, which left your mother forever bound to a wheelchair. And you soon kind of embarked on this great spiritual quest following, you know, again, flying from one school to another, trying out what works for you. How have you tried to explain that to you? Because if you truly think that way, if that link it still stays in your head, it's a pretty hard thing to live with, you know, to think that every time you think of your success, you think of your mother's accident. So how have you kind of explained that to yourself?
That's a great question. Your questions are amazing, I have to just say. That I think may never actually go, but the potency obviously has gone away. But one great, perhaps one benefit of actually starting my career, literally on the edge of a knife, I call it, because on one side was fame, money, reputation, accolades, and on the other side was great personal tragedy. And so they will be forever linked. But perhaps the incredible benefit of that has been that I have been able to understand from a young age that things, all of the aspects that we define as success, fame, money, status, actually don't solve the questions of the soul. They really, really don't. And I mean, I'm sure all of us have met people who seem to have it all, but you can still be profoundly unhappy. And the unhappiness can come from many different sources. But the point is that while it's great to have money, and I am not saying we certainly all need a certain amount of money, we all have ambition, we want validation from the world, but it does not actually heal you, it does not solve the questions of the soul. And I understood that from such a young age that it helped me to sort of move beyond that, and maybe perhaps a bit quicker, because this all happened at 16. And it's not that I suddenly had this revelation, but I can't help but think that the two kind of worked together to help me transcend. So I wasn't always, my ambitions became much different. My goals were not to become more and more famous, which probably explains a lot of my choices. You know, it wasn't about
the low-key projects that you picked.
All the projects that I said no to, because I really understood that perhaps also in some way that my answers were not waiting at the end of that. And on top of that, for who I am, there was a certain aspect of me that would even be extinguished by actually conforming to mainstream standards and taking those decisions and perhaps going full hog into Bollywood at the time when I was being offered big mainstream roles.
I just want to give a quick summary, because not everyone here has probably read the book already, to kind of explain this, the edge of a sword that you're talking about, is that very briefly, you must read the book. It's a 400-page book. This is a 2-minute summary of just the first 1/4 of it. Is that when Lisa was 16 and before starting university, she decided to take a gap year. Her parents became part of this adventure and they moved to Bombay, which is after this whole Croatia and Europe adventure. There's also a Mr. V, but I think we won't get into that. Let people read that bit. There's a Mr. V in London when she's 16. But anyway, parents come here and they decide, hey, it's a great idea to just stay at ISKCON. And, you know, we can, instead of renting a flat, but they weren't really into it. So her mother was sneaking in chicken soup and Lisa was out partying almost every night. Details of the parties and the people she met, very candid, are all in the book. Then they left ISKCON and went back. And in this brief idyllic period of, you know, again, Lisa's supposed to start university, they have a car accident, which leaves Lisa with a mild neck injury, a father almost unscathed, but her mother is then rendered, you know, she's bound to a wheelchair. And while Lisa, who's again still 16, is kind of helping her family and helping her mother recuperate, it's a bit too much for her, which is when Maureen Wadia, who had kind of taken her under her wing in the 1 year that she was in Bombay earlier, part of her hard parting years, kind of flies down to Canada and offers to kind of chaperone her life back in India. So it's a tough decision for a 16-year-old to make. Should I be, I really need to leave this place because I'm, you know, just going to a hospital every day as much as I love my mother is, I don't know how I'm helping. But it was a big decision to make and it must have caused a lot of heartache and agony about whether to stay or whether to come back. And I think from there on, Lisa's life was always kind of 1 foot in India, 1 foot in Toronto, and many other feet, other parts of the world. You have many feet. So it was always a kind of back and forth from here to there, which I think also kind of, you know, sets up the 2 points of your spiritual quest. It seems like a Toronto, Mumbai at two ends and many other things in between.
It's also been, I guess, an expression of straddling two worlds or multiple worlds, which, you know, because I'm of mixed blood, you know, us mixed breeds kind of occupy this very interesting space. And fortunately, there's more of us today. I think we should take over the world eventually, Obama in case. But I think that, you know, there what you end up occupying a very interesting space because you have an insight into both of these worlds, but you never fully belong into either of them, you know? And you develop, I think, this unique ability to be adaptable, you know, to change according to the situation, you know? I am personally very aligned to India. I actually, in my head, I'm Indian, and India is my country and the place I feel most connected to, but I have Polish blood, and I'm fluent in Polish. And my Polish grandmother brought me up. I learned Polish, it was my first language. So there is that aspect, and of course, you know, when I'm traveling, people can't pin me down. They can't put me in a box. They can't label me. Who are you and where are you from exactly is a question I've gotten relentlessly in my life. And it led to a lot of identity issues.
But it excited you as well. I mean, you really drew from that in your modeling career, right? This idea of being anybody and everybody.
It very much excited me. But, you know, perhaps on a deeper level, you know, that is what perhaps set me questioning to say, well, who am I really, or who am I beyond all these identities? Because the one thing that I've always chafed against is living within those boxes and those labels. And I had to do it from a young age because when I was 16, I was a sex symbol, you know? And it was completely unanticipated, completely, serendipitous. But to suddenly become this figure for an entire nation, and on top of that, to look much older, that has kind of haunted me my entire life, you know, up until now, this book probably, where a lot of people won't understand how I've always had this ambivalent relationship with my career, how I'm an accidental actress, how I've always had 1 foot in it, 1 foot out of it, and how I believe that I've been underestimated as well, only because of the way that I look, although I don't feel that they should be at odds with each other.
But unfortunately, I mean, I think preconceived notions take a while. Since you use the word serendipity, I want to kind of just mention that little passage you have about the etymology of the word. So apart from all, you know, the spiritual quests and the anecdotes and the shoe hitting men with shoes, etc., there's also a lot of poetry referenced. There's some of Lisa's original poetry as well. And there's a lot of referenced reading. So there's, I learned in the book and I studied linguistics and I learned it from your book that the word serendipity is actually comes from Serendib, which is a name for Sri Lanka, and it's from a short story called The Three Princes of Serendip, which was a story about how just unusual things or surprising things keeps happening to the princes. So that's the etymology of serendipity, one of the things I learned from the book. So
and one of my favorite words.
Yeah, and there are recipes in here as well. So there's like something for everyone as you go along. I think this is now an excellent point after we talk about, you know, worldly knowledge and travel, to talk about your kind of spiritual road trip across India with a man called Krishna, which I would call serendipity as well, as your co-traveler, in a gold Hyundai. Like just drop that in there and just tell everybody how that came to be. You traveled from Dharamshala to Osho Ashram in Pune.
I had decided, I had been on a 6-month long retreat, also serendipitous, which has been really the mistress in my life. But you know, in Dharamshala, where I had been immersed in Tibetan Buddhism, and you know, at the core of a lot of Buddhist teaching is this concept called emptiness, which is really nothing exists as we believe it does. And you know, when you really meditate on it for long periods of time, it becomes like you feel yourself disappearing. So I decided that maybe I need to take a little bit of a journey around India to see what other people have to teach, because I literally felt myself disintegrating at one point. So Krishna and I decided, we went back to Delhi. We bought a golden Hyundai. I believe that I actually sold off a piece of art, a Paritosh Sen that I had. And with that, we ended up buying a golden Hyundai, and we embarked on this spiritual road trip where there was literally no map. There was no plan. I remember my auntie in Delhi, you know, I couldn't fully explain what my intentions are. She was quite horrified, but she kept throwing in Imodium and, you know, various other, you know, you need, you know, whatever, towels and, you know, all of this. Like, it was like a survival kit for me. And I kind of looked at her because I knew I wouldn't use any of it. It was such a kind of like a free fall experience and a true kind of a experiment with truly trying to align yourself with what is. You know, we in our life live these lives that are so circumcised by plans, by responsibilities, by the things that we should do. And a lot of the should start in our mind. And I did have an intention behind this trip, but I decided to take all the shoulds away. And we literally traveled back up to Dharamshala. We would meet, we'd clamber up the sides of mountains to meet Rinpoches or, you know, certain Babas in Himachal Pradesh, a lot of Babas actually, who would conduct these very esoteric kind of rituals on me, or rituals with human bones and things like that. And it, you know, it sounds maybe a little bit sensationalistic, but it, for a while, it felt very normal. And what was beautiful about it is while there were no plans, the plan would appear. And I really feel that more than anything else, what I derived out of that experience was this idea. I believe all the people in the world can be divided into two camps. Either you believe that life is for you or against you. And, you know, out of this very belief, fundamental belief system, a lot of your decisions follow. And because I thought that I believed that life is for me, this was the ultimate experiment in seeing, is life actually for me? If I completely surrender, I make no plans, but I have a golden car, I have enough money to go from place to place, and I see what appears on the road, where we are drawn, where we are called, where we are taken. Who tells us, who appears and says, you should actually, you know, take a right at the Chaiwala and go up into the mountains, and there's someone, I think, waiting for you there. What happens? So it was a wonderful experiment.
You've mentioned this shloka that became the central theme in your life that I believe you borrowed or stole from your character Kalyani in Water, which is live your life like the lotus flower. Could you just because I think they are making kind of gestures to me to finish, but I have lots of other things to talk about. We've still not spoken about body issues or cancer. So can we just speak about this really briefly?
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm. It was obviously life-altering experience to be part of this film, Water. And I've written quite extensively about that experience in the preparation. But in it, I came across this shlok that my character, Kalyani, says, and it's Padma Patram Evam Bhasa, which is live your life like the lotus flower. And it has become, it's just beautiful. And because of that, I actually ended up getting my only tattoo, which is of the lotus flower. And I made sure that there was also the water element as well to remind us how we have the ability, I think, to always float in this, you know, perhaps what we might perceive to be the dirty water or the sullied water around us. We can still remain unstained by that.
So Lisa, there's obviously a big cast of characters in the book, from family to all these really interesting men. My favorite is Marco, after Jason, of course, in the book. But who we turn to in terms of extreme happiness or extreme grief is kind of an indicator of how we value those people in our lives. And you write about how when you were diagnosed with cancer, when you first came to know, Deepa Mehta was one of the first people you called. So to get a sense of, you know, these kind of dynamics and close links in your world and to navigate the book, who were some of the other people that you called early on? Who did you feel close enough to kind of share this absolutely devastating moment with?
At that time, there were very, very, very few people. Oh, hi, sorry, there's my little Soleil. I'm just pointing out my two babies are here today. Hi. Okay, now we need the attention back here because I knew they would. Okay, bye. Bye, my love. Oh, and she's joy. Bye, Chuku. Bye. Bye, she's waving. Bye, my love. Bye, we love you. At that time, I was going through a very sort of introspective, very solitary period of my life. And there weren't honestly that many people that I reached out to. I reached out to a gentleman who had just started dating at that time, who I call Bobcat, and who ended up being very, very important and seminal and supportive. But that relationship broke up very soon after. After he walked with me through that time. My father was actually my absolute rock. My father's name is Salil. I've called him Saint Salil after that. And he had this incredible quiet resilience that, you know, we can't anticipate how anyone is going to react until we're in these very, very difficult circumstances. And considering I just lost my mother, I was really worried about revealing. I was more worried about sharing my diagnosis with my father than I was about getting through this. And my father just literally looked at me and he said, you know what? Now that we know what's wrong, we can do something about this. And don't worry, we're gonna get through this. And he infused me with such incredible quiet courage that, I think I owe a lot of the reason why I'm sitting here is due to my father, my Baba.
You've been very candid about your troubled relationship with your body. You've written about your bulimia. You've written about a much later experiment with Botox. And you've, in more recent years, you've been very open speaking about infertility and surrogacy. And I've noticed that everywhere you mention your daughters, you always say twins through surrogacy. What is your relationship with your body now, and what is it about your relationship with your body that you'd like to tell, your twin daughters? You've also written about how in order to connect with your body, you did a lot of, you learned mime theater and you got into yoga in a big way while in London. So where are we right now with Lisa Ray and the body?
I believe that I am, the most comfortable in my skin than I've ever been before in my life. And I think that that's also a function of age. It's a huge function of experience. It's a huge function also of introspection. And I think it's a really important something I do want to emphasize, because coming from the beauty industry, where I have been at the mercy of very stringent beauty standards my entire life, and have also been somewhat guilty of also endorsing very unrealistic beauty standards as well. I've been a part of that cycle, and I accept my responsibility in that. I feel that I feel very strongly about speaking about my personal experience today with who I am, and having been able to transcend that. Not entirely, there's still aspects of me, of course. I have my good days, I have my bad days. My days where I look at my arms and curse, or I feel fat and bloated, etc. But overall, it's become an entire package. And I just feel that a sense of responsibility of speaking out about it, how I'm at my healthiest. And ironically, I do feel at my most attractive today at 47 than ever before. Although when I look back at, you know, pictures of me when I was 16, 17, 18, I say, wow, I had, you know, a great body. But as I explain in my book, I was so, I had such a distorted view of myself, of my body, my looks and everything like that, that I felt incredibly ugly and incredibly insecure all the time. There wasn't a moment when I didn't feel insecure. And that's just, I think, such an important message to at least talk about openly again and again and again, particularly in the age that we're living in today of social media and young girls being overtly influenced by the images that they see of extremely unrealistic images. And I speak a lot about the pathology of perfection, and the one place where I broke through was on the red carpet. Now, the red carpet today is something that we all discuss and we all feel like it's the pinnacle of achievement for a celebrity, but it's not. It's horrible. You feel self-conscious. It takes 3.5 hours to get ready. I hate it, at least. Maybe I shouldn't speak on behalf of anyone else. It's deeply uncomfortable. There is so much criticism and judgment, mainly of women, I might add. Everything from the shoes that you're wearing to your hips to your makeup, to how you hold yourself, you know. And it's really, really destructive, I think, ultimately. And because I understood that, and I understood there's this unrealistic kind of perfection that is, you know, projected onto women on the red carpet, that's why when I chose to reveal my diagnosis of cancer from the red carpet, when I was 40 pounds overweight on steroids, it was a breakthrough movement for me, because I was taking this very highly public moment and subverting it and being able to use it to talk about, first of all, something that was deeply personal and deeply important, fighting for my life. And here I am, you know, I've been diagnosed with cancer, and I'm never, you know, I'm 40 pounds bloated on cancer, on steroids, but so what? I'm here and I'm alive, and I'm here to talk to you about who I really am. So that was, for me, a really, really seminal turning point in my life.
A concluding question before we open it up to the audience for a few questions is, we've established now that you are writing a second book and a third book, and you have said in interviews recently that the second book would possibly be the more pure cancer book, because cancer is just like less than 40 pages in this 400-page book. And then I have urged you to write the relationship book. So, and you've mentioned fiction. So, and I know in June you have the A.R. Rahman movie releasing, which is, so you're going to be busy with that for a while. So what are your, how do you see your publishing journey going forward? Your publishers are sitting right here, so you can make them happy as well. Where do you see yourself going? Are you already working on the second book? What have you learned from the whole writing and marketing and, you know, kind of production process of this book? Because it's not just you in a bedroom writing the book. So what has your entire kind of learning been?
Exactly. At some point we have to, you know, I think as writers, we do live so much in our head. And as an introvert by nature, I actually enjoy that. I really like the solitude. I really enjoy that aspect of writing. But at some point you have to take your head out of your ass and look around and realize that there is a reader out there. And how do I connect with that reader? And you actually gave me some good, you know, points to think about, Anandita. And I think that, you know, for the next one, I will probably try to streamline a little bit more, for sure. you know, this book is almost 400 pages, even I'm quite surprised, but I really stand by it because I felt that there were certain things that I had to say and it was the way that I'm saying it. And I just didn't want to compromise on that. The second one, I think I would have a slightly different point of view. I still believe in how it's told, you know? I believe in the purity of the writer's voice. I think that I will hopefully try to focus a lot more. You know, I did have a kind of, I procrastinated on this book. And basically, I think I'm going to have to convince my husband to get me a little cabin somewhere, Goa, or some such thing. And there's no substitute for me in terms of writing, of just carving out that time, taking out the 6 months, 6 to 8 months. Would you agree with me? Because you're going through a similar journey.
But that's for another time.
Yeah, that's for another time. But yeah, there's no substitute for carving out that time and focusing. I will just have a lot more clarity in my notes. But you know, to be honest, I'm not very rational about this, the creative process. I'll probably just throw myself back in and make a lot more mistakes and hopefully, you know, just go along for the ride again.
Thank you, Lisa. It was incredibly wonderful chatting with you. We're going to see if we have just two audience questions. Yes, go ahead.
Hi, Lisa. Hello. Shil from Crossword Bookstores. So the question is, the nomadic life, what you have led. So do you have any goals in life as of, apart from your spiritual journey, what you have embarked on? And second is, I guess most of we have grown up watching the Afreen. So can you tell us something more about that? Thanks.
I'll answer the Afreen question first. I have written about it. And I think I've shared a couple of interesting behind the scenes tidbits, kind of humorous as well. So you'll have to buy the book and read it for that. But there is, it is included in that. Yes, in terms of goals, I, you know, instead of goals, I always had a vision for my life. I prefer to have an overall vision for how I want my life to be, rather than specific goals. Within that, there are goals embedded, but I always knew that what was important was freedom. I always wanted time to be able to explore, to ask questions, to challenge, you know? Now, obviously, in order to serve this vision, I realized I had to make money independently. So, you know, there were goals, there were sort of shorter sub-goals. I have to make money, which is why I was in this business. This business has been very good to me because it's also flexible. I've had the flexibility to say work for 6 months, 8 months, a year, and then maybe take off. So I think that that has been a great benefit. But I was clear that I had to take time off. I didn't get sucked into it because in my vision of my life was having my freedom to explore, to understand the nature of life, to reveal, to connect, to understand what is love, to search, and to have experiences. The one goal as a child was writing and to have as many and as diverse experiences as possible.
One more question. I'm afraid we'll have to limit it to two. So anybody wants to go? Yes. But you could ask one and then we could... and then, of course, Lisa is going to be around so you can come up to her and speak with her. Can somebody pass this lady a mic?
Get two short questions, one for her and one for you. It's been a lot of fun and it's been on a lighter tone that we've discussed the book. So I have a slightly serious question because you ended on the possibility of the financial and the economic and the idea of making money. And just this morning, I was reading that 30,000 children, cancer patients are brought to Tata Memorial. And these are kids who are coming from not so financial background. So money does help, right, in a situation where you have the bandwidth to overcome lots of, so maybe, you want to say something?
No, thank you. Thank you for that. And that is an important question to address. And I do and have done as much cancer advocacy as I can since I was initially diagnosed. And by the way, I relapsed in 2012 as well, which hasn't been, I haven't spoken about as much. I absolutely agree with you. However, I've also written about my own financial difficulties, my own emotional difficulties. Now, I think that perhaps when addressing cancer in India specifically, part of it is financial, but part of it is also misinformation and education. I would start from awareness before I would even start from financial. Because in India today, I know for a fact, because I have traveled and collaborated with certain programs, collaborated with Tata Memorial and many other places in India, there are incredible outreach programs where a patient in need will find the financial support. But what's happening in India still today is that from a certain strata of society, first of all, there's a lot of fear, taboos in India about speaking about cancer openly, right? And misinformation and fear. And so the first step that I still feel is very relevant in India, speaking about it openly. And that's what I've been doing relentlessly because I feel that's how I can contribute. Now, in terms of also, once we gather awareness and then we can start bringing the patients and connecting them with the relevant places where they can start getting treatment. There are so many people, I'm sure that you know also, Sangeeta, so many people who would be willing, more than willing, to help financially. So to put all those pieces together, though, we need a really comprehensive ecosystem of awareness, preventative, education, financial, emotional support. Slowly, but that, you know, unfortunately in India, we're starting from the basics. I know people who I have also been speaking to people who also have, are educated, are exposed to the world and still don't know the first thing about cancer because they kind of shut down. You know, we also have to overcome the fear and the taboo about talking about it because you have to be able to know to ask for the help as well. But I absolutely agree, this is something we need to speak about and addressed relentlessly in India today.
Thanks for that wonderful answer because quite encouraging. If one is always struggling with it, and awareness before treatment. I think that's a wonderful answer to have.
Or both simultaneously.
And since I'm allowed the second question to you, I wanted to ask, like a beautiful woman like Lisa is sitting here, and she also said, and you also said that sometimes beauty does not get taken seriously. So when a Medha Patkar who is wearing a chola and wearing a khadi sari and propagating the rural causes is heard better than someone who is in fashionable clothing and propagating rural causes. So do you have any insight to give? I mean, somebody who looks so beautiful is not sometimes taken so seriously for her writing, so as to say.
Well, definitely. I wore a designer outfit because finally in my mid-30s, I have overcome that kind of stereotyping. I felt as a younger journalist that at an event like this, I would have tried to dress a little more seriously. But I think with age, you also kind of learn to be a little more comfortable in your skin. And I think all of us are actually a spectrum of many things. And the paper I edit, Lounge, I'm sorry that we are ending with something that's not about the book. The paper I edit, we are very proud of saying that, you know, we can as easily speak about bow ties and speak about, you know, actual cancer coaches in the same issue. Because I do think the same person or the same reader is interested in a wide spectrum, so we can be many things. And I'm finally okay with being interested in fashion and being interested in books and many other things. But it is a journey, and I feel you can't actually tell somebody that, they have to realize that at some point.
We can, if I can just add a little bit, I have written about it also in the book, you know, how sometimes to act out against what I feel the world was imposing on me, I walked around scruffy. Most of my life, I don't walk around like this at all. I'm very scruffy. I mean, I think you've seen me, Sangeeta. I don't wear makeup. I don't know the first thing about makeup.
You had your Italian boyfriend tell you, why are you trying so hard to be inelegant?
Yes, yeah, exactly. Why are you trying to be so inelegant? Because off duty, that's who I am. Nobody would honestly look twice. And I see this as both armor and sort of, it's my suit. This is me going to the office. And today I'm comfortable enough with myself that I can embrace both. I don't need validation because I know you know, I have some answers in my soul. I know who I am. I know who what I can contribute. I know I'm a very strong writer and intelligent. And just to leave it off here, I was just telling Anandita, and I was having a conversation with some friends out there. I said, you know, I had this moment when I was getting ready for this evening. I said, I think I should just not wear makeup, and I should appear like kind of scruffy and serious and a little bit, you know, undone. And my friends actually rallied around me, and they said, don't be mad. You know, and here's another kind of a thing that a lot of women are told. It's like, don't shine too big. You can't be all of these things. We're told this. I, by the way, don't consider myself, I swear, I don't consider myself beautiful. I think I photograph well. I think I have a great team. I have an incredible
team. Start of a whole different conversation.
That's a whole different conversation. But I just want to say that this passed through my mind. I said, I should be taken seriously. I've written what I believe. I actually believe it. I'm very self-critical. I believe it's a good book. I've poured myself. I've literally cut my veins open for this book. Every single word I own and belongs to me. So should I present myself differently? And then I said, you know what? Balls. We talked about this. Balls. It's okay to be proud of this book and my writing and to stand here and celebrate it. This is one way of celebrating it. And also, I'm in front of the camera and, you know, I'm trying to get what I believe is an important message out there. So I will leverage the platform that I have today in India. Why not? Thank you, everyone, so much for being here today. I just want to add, I'm so honored. I am deeply honored. This is such a deeply personal and special experience. I'm honored to all the readers. I'm all honored to all the supporters. I'm honored to all of my friends. I can't give a shout out to everyone, but you know who you are. They're my incredible supporters. I couldn't have done it without all of you. And to everyone who's here today, I don't want to get teary. I'm a little bit of an emotional bugger. But thank you so much for being here.
Don't get teary before you unwrap the book and they have the photo op. Akriti, will you join us?